celebrate this faithful God. Oh, we praise you, Jesus. There is none like you. Thank you, precious Father. All the glory back to you, Jesus. Every closed door is opening this morning. Every closed door of breakthrough is opening this morning. Every closed door of favor is opening up this morning. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, lift up your hands where you are. Father, thank you again. Faithful God, we bless you. You are not a man that you should lie. Neither are you the son of man to repent. Every word you speak, you bring it to pass. Now your word has said that when you open any door, no one can shut that door. Therefore, in the name above every other name, every door closed to your people, doors of breakthroughs, doors of favor, doors of increase, doors of advancement, I command those doors forcefully open. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, honor your word again this morning. And at the end of this amazing service, let your name alone be glorified. A believer in church this morning is shouting the loudest, amen. Give Jesus the biggest clap offering you can this morning. Hallelujah. Praise God. Please get comfortably seated. Amen. Well, just help me hold someone seated by your side. Just hold that person's hand. Squeeze that hand and just smile. Don't say nothing. Just squeeze the hand and smile. And if that neighbor is not smiling, please change your seat. Praise God. Come on, I said praise God. Well, if the neighbor is smiling, that neighbor is excited that God is opening a new door to you. I saw some people looking at their neighbors. Am I seated beside a dangerous neighbor this morning? Glory to God. Say with me, it's my season of glory. Come on, you can put some life to it one more time. That shall be your testimony this month. There is no member of this church family that will be a victim of shame. We began a teaching series last Sunday, and it's my joy this morning to welcome each and every one of us to our Covenant Day of Open Doors. I see that answering in your life. Riding the waves of glory. And that's what we've been looking at since the month began. And this morning, I'd like you to fasten your seatbelts this morning. For the Lord is set to take us up to a new height altogether. It's important for us as believers to understand the benefits of redemption. All of the blessings. All of the additions that salvation brings to mankind. Redemption is not just a religious experience. It's a life-transforming encounter. When you become saved, everything changes. You know, by redemption, every child of God becomes justified. And the essence of this justification is to end up in glorification. Come on, is somebody in church this morning? Romans chapter 8, verse 29 and verse 30. I'd like to read from the Amplified Translation this morning. Romans chapter 8, verse 29 and verse 30. Now, hear what the word says. Stay with me closely. For those whom he foreknew and loved and chose beforehand. And I believe you are someone like that here this morning. He also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. And ultimately, stay with me, share in his complete sanctification, so that he would become the firstborn, the most beloved and honored among many believers. Will somebody say amen to that? Let's watch this. And those whom he predestined, he also called them. And those whom he called, he also did what? Justified them. Now, watch the description of the word justified. He declared them free. Say with me, free. Of the guilt of sin. And those whom he justified, he also did what? Glorified. Come on, is somebody excited about that? Now, what does it mean to be glorified? It said he raises them to heavenly dignity. That's the place where you are right now. That's your experience right now. So no matter what the devil says to you, it's a lie. By redemption, you have been justified to be glorified. Come on, will you put a loud amen to that? Now help me jump to verse 33. Now, try to paint a clear picture of this. It said, who will bring any charge against God's own elect? How many of God's elect are in church this morning? Ooh, his chosen ones. It is God who justifies us. He declares us blameless and puts us in right relationship with him. I love one translation. It says, you are no more impeachable. You know what it means to impeach? That's a dangerous political term. Some people need to be impeached. I stop there. But by redemption, you can't be impeached of your status. So your realm of glorification is established no matter who speaks against you. That's what redemption does. So no matter the accusation of the devil, as long as you are saved and genuinely redeemed, those accusations are worthless. From today, you begin to ride on the waves of glory. But to ride on these waves, we can only do so by engaging the diverse operations of the Holy Ghost. And that's important. For it's not by power. Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 6. It's not by power. It's not by might. But by my spirit, saith the Lord. Now from scriptures, we understand that the Holy Ghost is a multi-dimensional entity. The Holy Ghost is a multi-operational personality. I show you that from scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We read from verse 4 through to verse 7. Let's put that quick. It says, and now there are diversities of gifts. Come on now. But the same Spirit. There are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of the operations, but it is the same God. Say with me, the same God. Which worketh all in all. The same Holy Ghost manifesting in diverse operations. Now, but the manifestation of the Spirit, and this is the interesting part, is given to every man, and that covers you. to profit wither. So all of the manifestations of the Holy Ghost is ordained for the profitable living of the saints. And this morning, quickly, I'd like to introduce the Holy Ghost in three dimensions. Stay with me. The Holy Ghost is called the Spirit of Faith. The same Holy Spirit is also known as the Spirit of Faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 13. We haven't the same Spirit of what? Of faith. According as it is written, I believed, therefore have I what? Spoken. So this Holy Spirit, the Spirit of faith, empowers the believer to believe the impossible and speak the unspeakable. When this Spirit takes a hold of the saint, it develops your capacity to believe what humanly cannot be believed. You know, there are certain things that the Lord speaks to you. It takes the operation of the Spirit of faith for you to receive them. For instance, there are many things the Lord has spoken concerning you in 2018. And we've gotten to the 10th month. And someone is saying, I've not seen no signs of what the Lord has said concerning me. Now, what you need is an expanded faith capacity. For blessed is she that believeth. There shall be a performance. So the performance will only answer to the operation of faith. Luke chapter 1 and verse 45. God has no problems bringing to pass what his mouth has declared. All he needs is your faith. So every time the Spirit of faith is at work, it empowers the believer to rise above the challenging circumstances of life. Now, I know you may be faced with difficult situations. You may be faced with challenging situations. All hope may seem bleak. The persons you thought would support you may have turned their backs on you. Many that you have cried to may have turned deaf ears to you. Well, may I say this to you? All you need is the Spirit of faith. If you have got God, you have got all you need. You don't need no man if God is on your side. And as long as faith is working on your inside, you have secured the hand of God. For without faith, it is impossible to please God. So in other words, with faith, it is possible to please God. Lift up your hands where you are this morning. I pray from the depth of my soul for a fresh infilling of the Spirit of faith upon everyone here. You receive that, shout aloud, amen. The Spirit of faith empowers the saint to live a life of no limits. No barriers. Nothing can stand on your path. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 16. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you'll be able to quench. Come on now. How many? Come on, respond to me this morning. How many? All the fury, that's of the wicked. So no matter the arrow or the assault of the wicked that is sent in your direction, taking the shield of faith will quench them. Well, no matter who shoots any arrow in your direction, this month they return back to send them. Come on, if there's someone of faith this morning, shout aloud, amen. You know what faith does? It gives you unstoppable victory. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 4. For whatsoever is born of God, overcometh the world and all the challenges of the world. And this is the victory. The victory. The victory. Come on, somebody's picking that right now. This is your victory. That overcometh the world, even your faith. Even your faith. So when your faith gets on the go, every opposition clears off the way. You will win this battle. I just prayed for somebody right now. You are coming out victorious. Now, what the spirit of faith does is this. It empowers us to tap into the sovereign authority of the Almighty. Anytime the spirit of faith gets at work on your inside, it gives you access to the sovereign authority. So everything that answers to God answers to you. Now think of this. When Elisha received the mantle of Elijah in 2 Kings chapter 2, what he received amongst others was the spirit of faith. And we saw Elijah part Jordan hither and thither. Now, before that time, Elisha never had the capacity for it. But the instance that he picked the mantle from Elijah, everyone acknowledged that the spirit of Elijah now rested upon Elisha. And that was the same spirit that speaks and believes what is spoken. And Elijah got to the same Jordan, and the Jordan was closed, and he stood before Jordan and said, "Where is, come on now, the God of my father?" And he smote the waters. And the Bible says that the same way the waters divided hither and thither for Elijah, it divided for Elisha. May I speak over someone's destiny this morning? Every barrier on your path must be cleared off this time. No matter what is confronting your destiny, by the operation of the spirit of faith, you are coming out victorious. Come on, you believe that? Wave your hands and shout aloud, amen. Never assume this spirit. Consciously acquire it. Don't assume the spirit of faith. You need it. I need it. Every believer needs the spirit of faith. When it gets at work, nothing becomes too difficult for you to believe. You know, many of the undoings of the saint is doubt. The spirit of doubt. Now, this is God speaking to you, saying, "This is what I will do." And then you go to your quiet place and you say, "How can this thing be? I earn $5 an hour. And God is saying, I will buy a house in 2018. Even if the heaven should open." You know, that was what that technocrat said to the prophet. The prophet said, "By this time tomorrow." You know, when God speaks, he speaks according to his capacity, not your limited capacity. When he speaks according to his ability. So never match God with man. They don't operate at the same class. By this time tomorrow, may I speak to somebody, before this year is over, you will still buy that house. Come on, someone's faith is receiving it right now. Before 2018 is over, that miracle will still land for you. Say with me, "I believe." It says, contend for the faith that was once given to the church. Jude 1:3. Earnestly contend. Don't assume. Go for it. Quickly, number two. The second dimension of the Holy Ghost this morning is the spirit of servanthood. the spirit of servanthood or stewardship. Isaiah 42 from verse 1 through to 4. Now watch what the word says. It said, behold my servant whom I uphold, and he called him my elect, in whom my soul delighted. Watch this. He said, I have put my spirit upon him. And that covers you also. He shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. Verse 2, he shall not cry, nor lift up, nor cause his voice to be heard in the streets. He said, a bruised reed shall he not break, and the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment unto truth. Verse 4, he shall not fail. Come on now. Not be discouraged. So when the spirit of servanthood is at work on your inside, you can't fail in your stewardship. You can't be discouraged in your stewardship. You know, many times the devil positions people to break your stewardship to God. They talk you out of serving God. They said to you, is it every Sunday must you go? You have worked all week. Sunday is for sleeping. Remember the Sabbath day, keep it holy. They manipulate your mind. You get serving God and they just release themselves to discourage you. Discourage you by the words to speak. Discourage you by their attitude. But when the spirit of servanthood comes, it says you will not fail. You will not be discouraged. Say what you want. I'm not serving you. I'm serving God. Many times I wonder what on earth can ever make me stop serving this God. Say what you like. It's your mouth. Look at me with your eyes. They belong to you. But there is nothing under heaven. Because when I come to church, I'm not coming to see your face. When I stand serving my Father in the kingdom, I'm not serving to please you. Believers need to understand why we are serving God. It gets so pathetic when you hear believers say, I'm not coming to church. Why? Somebody looked at me like this. And I said to them, you look at him like this. Peradventure there was something in the person's eyes. Just pray that the Lord heal your eyes. And then you keep serving your God. But when the spirit of servanthood is at work on your inside, you cannot be discouraged. You know what he said? He said, I will put my spirit within you. Ezekiel 36 verse 27. I will put my spirit within you. And this spirit will cause you to walk in my statutes. You naturally just line up with the demand of stewardship. Nothing becomes strong enough to break your service to God. Every time I think of what the Holy Ghost turned Peter the apostle to, I wonder. Peter was a weakling disciple. Peter couldn't stand for Christ even when confronted by a little girl. But when the Holy Ghost came, when the infilling of the spirit came, when the spirit of servanthood descended upon Peter, Acts chapter 4, the entire Jewish leadership from verse 1 to 6 came against Peter, threatening him, giving them all kinds of threats. But jump over to verse 7. I love the response Peter gave. And when they have set them in the midst, they ask, by what power or by what name have you done all of this? Now watch what Peter said. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, filled with the Spirit, spirit of servanthood. He said to them, ye rulers of the people, elders of Israel. Verse 9, if we this day be examined of the good deed that has been done to this impotent man, by what means he was made whole. Verse 10, he said, be it known, I'm not scared of you. Boldness rose up in Peter. The Peter that was running away, denying Christ. But when he became filled with the Spirit, he said, be it known unto all of you and all of Israel that by the name of Jesus of Nazareth, whom you all crucified, terrible people, you killed him. I can say it now. There's something else moving on my inside. That was the Peter that could not stand before a child. But when the Holy Ghost filled him, it transformed the engine power on his inside. You know, when you see some vehicles, the movement of the vehicle is defined by the power of the engine. There are some, they move like this. By the motion of the vehicle, you can tell the power of the engine. But there are some, just the sound. It means clear off. I was looking at my power bike. Side by side, some of the bikes where I used to come from. And I was trying to compare the engine capacity. Where I come from, we have some nice, tiny street bikes. When it starts, you may not hear. Even the way it moves tells you the capacity of the engine. But when I kick my Harley Davidson, now, even if you are asleep, you wake up. From the garage, my house feels that something is charging up. So the boldness and the intensity of the engagement is defined by what is working on the inside. Peter could not speak against the child, but when the Holy Ghost filled him, the spirit of servanthood entered him. He could stand before the entire Israel. And he said to them, be it known to you, terrible people, that in the name of Jesus, the one you crucified, is that same name that has made this one whole. May I speak over somebody this morning? Everything that has confronted your destiny before now, from today you begin to walk over them. Any enemy that stands in your path, you will clear them this time. You will gallantly walk over them this time. Come on, if you receive that, say it with a loud amen. So the Holy Ghost simply empowers our stewardship beyond our natural capacity. You just serve God and you are lost in your stewardship. Others may not come, but you are there. Others may not show up, but you are there. You are not waiting to be reminded to serve your Maker. You know, there's some Christians, until you call them at 9, and say, service starts at 10, that's when they remember. But they clock in 1 hour before time in their place of work. Am I saying something this morning? Well, the spirit of stewardship will change that level. Quickly, number 3, let's move. The third dimension of the Holy Ghost is the spirit of revelation. The spirit of revelation. Revelation simply connotes access to the deep things of God. The deep things of God. It connotes the unfolding of divine secrets. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, from verse 9 to 12, the word says, but it is written, I have not seen, ears have not heard, neither has it entered. entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them. Not those in church, but for them that do what? That love him. Verse 10. It said, but God has what? Revealed them unto us by his Spirit. Capital S. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. He said, for what man knoweth the things of a man save the Spirit which is inside that man? So even the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. So it is the Spirit of God that can reveal the deep things from God. Many times we crave to access revelation with our mental capacities. It can't work. It takes the Holy Ghost to go deep and uncover the hidden truths of scriptures. You know, the word revelation comes from a root word called apocalypsis. The word apocalypsis means to unveil something hidden or something concealed. It talks about removing the veil of deception that's been placed over even believers and to expose the truth of God's word. You know, even believers have been covered. The eyes of believers many times are covered. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Verse 3 and 4. It said, for if the gospel be hid, now it is hid to them that are lost, whom the God of this world had blinded the minds of them, so they believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, which is the express image of God, should shine unto them. So the devil uses the blindfolding weapon from hell, covers the eyes of believers. They are shouting, but ignorantly so. They are shameful of what is gainful. At the midweek communion service this week, we had a testimony of someone who always used to come to church, and every time the communion is served, he leaves it in his mouth and goes out after the service to spit it out. So he took it when it is distributed, so nobody will say he's not partaking of it. But he keeps it. After he partakes of the communion, he can't talk anymore. How are you? And he's rushing outside the auditorium. But one fateful day, he mistakenly swallowed it. So I believe they gave it to him and somebody asked him, how are you? And he forgot there was something in the mouth. I was trying to say, I'm fine. And it entered. He said, I mistakenly swallowed it. But that mistakenly swallowing experience mistakenly delivered him from oppression. That same night, in the dead of the night, around midnight, the system began to react. And that demonic planting on his inside was let go from his body. And an age-long affliction was terminated that same night. I've had my father say this. It is foolishness to be shameful of what is gainful. It is foolishness to be shameful of what is gainful. So what the Holy Ghost does is to clear off our eyes of every spiritual blindfolding, and we begin to operate in some realms of revelation of the truth of God's word that now sets us free from the shackles of the wicked. John chapter 16, verse 13 to 15, he said, for how be it when he, the Spirit of truth, shall come, speaking of the Holy Ghost, he will guide you into all truths. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. and he will show you things to come. You know, the Holy Ghost can tell you where your next breakthrough is coming this week. The Holy Ghost can lead you to where your next miracle job will land. Sometime in 2015, in Washington, D.C., we had this amazing sister who had been believing God for a miracle job for so long. And it seemed not to be coming forth. One fateful day, she was going either to make her nails or something. And she had a voice of the Holy Ghost say, "Hey, go into this office." Now, she had dropped her resume in that place long time, no call. And she walked in almost at the closing hour. I think that was a Friday. And she walked into the same place. Now, everywhere, all of the staff had probably all closed. She looked around, nobody. And she went into the restroom. Lo and behold, she met another lady there. And she began to get into it. She got into a conversation with this lady. And said, "I submitted my resume here some months ago, but I just stopped by to see if there was anything going on." And the person said, "Really? Come with me to my office." Not knowing that the person she met was the HR manager. May the Lord lead you to where your breakthrough is waiting. Interview conducted after hours. Job given after hours. Resumption the next week. Everything turned around like a dream of the night. May I pray for somebody here? The Lord will turn your captivity like a dream of the night. So walk with this Holy Spirit. Partner with him. He will imbibe and infuse into you the spirit of faith, the spirit of servanthood, and grant you access to the deep things from the Lord. You will never be stranded again. I say you will never be stranded again. Now, on this special covenant day of open doors, I see you accessing open doors. Help me with Revelation chapter 3, verse 7 and verse 8. I'd like us to read this scripture together. Help with the Amplified translation. Amplified, please. Okay, I'd like us to read it together. Are you there? Okay, come on, let's go. 1, 2, go. "And to the angel, divine messenger of the church in Philadelphia." Now, you stop there. Stop there. The last time I checked, Philadelphia is in the East Coast. But I'm in Dallas. So let's change that scripture a little bit. Are you with me this morning? When I saw Philadelphia, I began smiling. I said, I will change this thing today to Dallas. Is somebody with me? Okay, so let's change it to Dallas. 1, 2, go. "And to the angel, divine messenger of the church in Dallas, write, these are the words of the Holy One, the true one, he who has the key to the house of David, he who opens and no one will be able to shut, and he who shuts and no one opens. Verse 8, I know your deeds. See, I have set before you an open door which no one is able to shut. For you have a little power and have kept my word and have not renounced or denied my name." May I say this to you? You came to church this morning and you have come not to deny the name of Jesus. Therefore, every closed door must be open today. Woo! He said, "I am set to open impossible doors. And when I open those doors of breakthroughs, they may not like your face. They may not like your skin color. They may not like your looks. But they can't do nothing about those doors." Someone will walk into that company for interview this week. They'll look at you. Just give him the job. I don't like you, but I will give it to you. Because when God opens a door, there's no man that can close that door. Doors will open miraculously for you this week. You know what it means to experience open doors? Last week, one of our sisters shared a testimony who went for an interview in one of the first 100 companies in the US. And got at the point of interview. The lady asked her, what countries are you coming from? Where did you come from? And she said the name of the country. I said, I was at a wedding with people from this country. And we danced. And interview became discussion. And she said, in fact, you have got a job. Well, she has resumed. Mega job. Fantastic job. Because when God opens a door, nobody can shut that door. Is somebody hear what I'm saying this morning? As a child of God, you are entitled to open doors. Now, what does open doors, or what do we mean by open doors? Number one, it means unstoppable advancement. Unstoppable. Where nothing can stop you from making progress. You know what the scripture says in Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 18? It said, but the path of the justified is as a shining light. It shines brighter more and more until the perfect day. The perfect day is the day Jesus returns. So your path as a redeemed child of God is ordained to get better every passing day. In other words, you should never have a better yesterday. Did somebody hear what I'm saying? Life is not designed for ups and downs. It's designed for ups and ups. Don't buy that lie of the devil that everyone is under pressure. It's a lie. Ooh, big fat lie. There are members of this assembly that are not under any trace of pressure. They may be sitting next to you. Not any iota of pressure. Someone shared a testimony of a breakthrough. And where I stood, I was just shaking my butt. I said, and it was just a top up on the blessing. You know what it means to have a top up on the blessing? That means you are enjoying the blessings, but God just says, I need to move you to the next level. Let me just top it up. God will top somebody's blessing this time. Unstoppable advancement. Oh, how we need it. Too many people remain on the same spot for too long. Year after year, month after month, decade after decade, you can't tell what has moved in the life of that person. On the outreach field sometime last year, I met a man who told me I've been in this nation for 34 years. He said, Pastor, I know you. I said, okay. He said, I was trying to preach to him and he said, don't bother, I know you. So I paused. I said, okay. So tell me, what's going on? He said, I've been in this nation for 34 years. He said, but I can't trace anything tangible I've done with my life. He said, every attempt for progress closed doors. And he has been struggling like that for decades. And I began to think, how many years does this man have to live on the earth to remain on the same spot for 34 years? You know, it's possible for people to remain on the same spot for so long. The man at the pool of Bethesda was there for 38 years. And he kept saying, there's no man to help me. Jesus said, you don't need no man. All you need is the God that opens doors. And those doors must be opened in your favor this time. Remember, whatsoever is born of God, overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcomes even your faith. Nothing will stop your progress this time. Now, open doors also connotes new opportunities. Experiencing new opportunities. Now, thank God for your past experiences. Thank God for your past breakthroughs. It says, for the former things that come to pass, new things do I declare. Remember ye not the former things, neither consider the things of old. For behold, I do a new thing. You know one thing about this God, he loves doing new things. He will just desire just to open a new door for you. You may not think you need it, but he just desires a new experience for you. May I ask this morning, is there anyone here who can do with a little more blessing? Come on, can you do it a little? I know you are blessed. I know you are blessed people, but can you do with just a little more blessing? Just like a top up blessing? Come on, lift up your hands. Let me see you properly. Do you need a little more blessing? Where those hands lifted, we touch those blessings. One of our precious ones in this assembly was busy enjoying and having a fantastic time in his place of work. All of a sudden, he got an email, asked to come for an interview, and he checked. This is from a higher governmental position. I didn't apply for this. I'm having a fantastic time here. I don't need anything more. I'm grateful to God. But God was in a hurry to change his level. Well, he said, let me go for the interview. And he went casually, did the interview, passed the interview, and they scanned him in and out, even to the place where he was born. Well, the good news is this, the new opportunity that God has given to this son of God is such that when you hear the visitation, it will make your ears to tingle. You know, there are certain blessings that God will slap you with. That when you share it, when people hear it, they do like this. Did I hear well? That's what will happen to somebody here. New opportunities. Thank God for where you are, but there's something bigger than where you are. And God is taking you there this time. Number three, what do we mean by open doors? As we gradually get to a close, we mean the elimination of barriers. Because when the door is open, nothing can stop your motion. He said, for who art thou, O mountain, to stand before Zerubbabel? Zechariah chapter 4 verse 7. What is that mountain that can stand? What is that barrier that can stop your motion? For when the door is open, your motion is released. Somebody is gaining speed this time. I said somebody is gaining speed this time. But for the door to be open, you need a key. When you hold the key to the door, you don't sweat. When you have the key in your pocket, you don't struggle. Even the tongues you speak, they are reduced tongues. Why? You have the key in your hand. So the door is at your command. Now let me share with us one key that will keep the door open. And that's the master key of love. Love for all times remains the master key to open doors. When we are genuinely in love with God, all things begin to work together for our good. Well, have you not heard Romans chapter 8 and verse 28? For we know that all things worketh together for what? For good. Even the devil is a thing. So when he thinks that the trap is set for you will lead to your destruction, God says, for my lovers, all things will always work together for the good. That challenge you are going through will work together for your good. Come on, somebody say a louder amen to them. That situation you are confronted with will work together for your good. But what does it mean to love God? Number one, if you love God, you will love his word. Psalm 119 verse 97. Oh, how love I thy law. If you love this God, you will love his word. So you want to check how much you love him? Check how much you love his word. There are many Sunday tonic believers today. The only time they read the Bible is the one projected on the screen. The only time they touch the Bible is Sunday morning. And they say to him, hey, Junior, where's my Bible? Junior said, where you left it last Sunday, Dad? And he goes and picks the Bible. So much dust. You guys are not doing a good cleaning job in this house. It shows he has not touched that Bible for the last 2 weeks. And he keeps the Bible under the armpit and is coming to church. So he can't reference one scripture. You know, there are believers like that. Can't quote one. I'm not even half. You know, there's the shortest scripture is Jesus wept. They don't know it. Jesus wept. They can't tell where it is. You love him, you will love his word. You will love to hear from him. Every one of us here must have been in love at one time or the other. Many of us are still in love right now, like me. You love to hear the word of your lover. Every time the call is coming, you are in a hurry to pick. Why? You want to hear the words of your lover. So if you are in love with this God, you will love to hear his word. Somebody hear what I'm saying? Number two, proof of your love. If you love God, you will love his house. The house of your lover is never too far. Mm-mm. Dallas to Austin is like moving from here to Plano. Driving 6 hours to check your lover is like driving 6 minutes. You just enter the car. You say, where are you going? I'll be back. How far is the journey? Doesn't matter. All that is motivating you is the love affair. So you drive 6 hours like you are driving 6 minutes. Because the house of your lover is never too far. I knew how many flights I took those days. Flying was like nothing. Any airline, is there a seat? Business, anything, just pay. Why? Somebody's waiting at the other side. Am I saying something? The house of your lover is never far. There are people that drive 1 hour, 30 minutes to come to church here. 1 hour, 30 minutes, one way. Because they love this God, they can't miss his house for a minute. And then you are 5 minutes away. You say, oh, goodness. I'm so tired. The weather is so... Then you stretch, say, oh, I love you. Jesus, more than anything. Jesus says, shut up. Shut that mouth. You love what? If you love me, my house won't be far from you. Did somebody hear what I'm saying? David said, I was glad when they said to me, come, let us go to the house of the Lord. Stand to your feet this morning. How many God lovers are in church this morning? Come on, how many God lovers are in church this morning? Let me see you wave those hands. How many God lovers are in church this morning? Glory to God. Come on, I said glory to God. We're going to dance in a moment. We'll partake of the communion today. And then celebrate God in some victory praise. Because that's how you'll be dancing and walking through those open doors. Did you hear the ministration of the choir this morning? It said, I'm walking, walking, walking through my open doors. But very quickly, let's get this done before we partake of the communion. All heads bowed. One moment. We've gotten to the climax of the service this morning. Every provision of scripture is available only to the redeemed. The talk of glorification, honor, is only available by redemption. But the good news is this: Jesus never came to condemn the world. Jesus never came to condemn you. Rather, he has come to restore you back to himself. So all he's saying is this morning is this: give me the opportunity. Come back home. Peradventure, where you are standing or seated all across this amazing facility this morning, you know in your heart and there's a craving of your soul to get reconnected back to Jesus. There's a vacuum on your inside longing to be filled. The arms of Jesus are wide open this morning. He said, come home. Let me give you a fresh beginning. Come home. Let me give you a fresh start. All heads bowed. You want to say, Pastor Steve, please pray with me this morning. I want to start on a whole new fresh frequency with Jesus. Or peradventure you want to rededicate your life to him. That's okay. Please place your right hand on your chest. Give me that honor to pray with you this morning. You are saying yes to Jesus. Or rededicating your life to him all across this building. Your right hand on your chest as I pray with you this morning. Say this word of prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I come to you today. Forgive me my sins. Wash me with your blood. I repent of every wrong. From this moment, I am born again. I'm a child of God. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name. And the entire church says aloud, amen. Now you said that prayer. Your hand was on your chest. Give me the honor to place a seal on your declaration. May I request that you take that bold step before the Lord this morning and come forward and stand with me. Take that bold step. Thank you, my brother. Take that bold step. Make way for them as they come. Make way for them. Thank you, my brother. Someone is coming. Come on, church. Thank you, my sister. Are you clapping for them as they come? Come on, church. Let's give Jesus a big hand. Please stand with me. Someone else is coming. Someone else is coming. Thank you, my sister. Come on, church. Are you excited? Jesus is touching lives this morning. That's what we have come to do this morning. Thank you, my sister. All the way the back, they're coming. Come on, keep clapping for Jesus as they come. Keep clapping, keep clapping. Keep clapping, keep clapping. This is the best decision anyone can make. That's the best decision anyone can make. Now, there are still two people. Two. I'm very confident of what I'm saying. Two people. You are fighting that decision in your heart right now. Oh, should I come out or not? Well, don't close that door by your hand. Jesus is set to open a new chapter to your life. All he's asking you this morning is take that bold step and stand with me this morning. Thank you, my sister. Someone else is coming. Someone else is coming. Someone else is coming. We are waiting for just one person. We are in a hurry to partake in the communion. Just one person. Well, I know what I'm saying. Just one person. Don't close the door God is about to open with your hands. Come on, church. Are you giving Jesus a big hand? Glory to God. Well, you are still free to join us. Please bow your head as I pray with you. Heavenly Father, thank you today for these precious ones you have drawn to yourself. Your grace, Jesus, has saved them. Let the same grace preserve them. Right now, I soak each one of them in the pool of the blood of Jesus. The hand of the wicked is rebuked over your destinies. And I declare every closed door of breakthrough must be opened from now. In the name of Jesus. And so shall it be. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Church, help me say louder, amen. The Lord bless you real good. Please go with our kingdom friends. They'll place something in your hand and then you join us. God bless you. God bless you, sir. God bless you. God bless you.